Our intention is to make ourselves as good in our craft as we can, as highly trained and as flexible as possible, so that we can be very alive to the present.
Ahead of his time, a risk taker and often controversial, Sir Peter Hall was at the forefront of British theatre and opera for more than 50 years.
My heroes are not politicians and they're not philosophers. My heroes are Shakespeare and Mozart.
As the founder of the Royal Shakespeare Company, he changed the cultural identity of the nation and was bold and innovative, always in pursuit of talent.
As in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs.
He made an incredible difference to me, who taught me all I know about speaking verse.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming.
A passionate campaigner for the arts, he ran the National Theatre for 15 years, seeing it through some of the most tumultuous times to triumph.
I would have thought anyone running a theatre anywhere else in the world today would have to look to Peter Hall for inspiration.
This was the most exhilarating, creative director that I'd ever worked with.
You here, my dear...
Peter created an immense sense of security and strength, and from that strength, a freedom.
Peter's status as the great director impresario of the age is unchallengeable.
Part politician, part manager, part celebrity.
He basically is the story of post-war British theatre.
At the height of the Great Depression, in Bury St. Edmunds, West Suffolk, Peter Reginald Frederick Hall was born on November 22nd, 1930, the only child of Grace and Reg, a lifelong railwayman.
They came from humble origins. Basically, his father became a railway worker and through his own endeavours became a station master, which was sort of extraordinary in that most people before had been painters and decorators, farm labourers, farm hands. My grandmother worked in a haberdasher's shop and was a shop girl, basically.
She wasn't really terribly pleased with her lot in life, and so I think she expected him to do better for the whole family.
He had no brothers and sisters. He had to fall back on his own imagination, his own play-acting imaginary world.
He came from a family that had little to no cultural exposure. This was something that he found completely, you know, on his own.
Music, I suppose, was his first love, and of course, was something he could do. He didn't need other people.
When he was 10 years old, he asked his parents to take him to a performance of Mozart's Requiem.
Sounds awful to go to Mozart's Requiem on my 10th birthday. It sounds ridiculous, but I did, because I was really very interested in music.
It was just like the opening of the universe. Anything was possible.
As a boy, Peter's family had moved to Cambridge. It was a revelation.
Cambridge in the war was a place of wonder, because it was absolutely full of people in the arts who'd been evacuated from London. There was an absolute welter of plays, concerts, recitals. And I was there with my pocket money and my newspaper round, imbibing them.
His enthusiasm gained him a scholarship to an independent school with inventive ways of exploring literature and drama.
By allowing little boys to shout Shakespeare at each other with little cloaks and swords. And I remember that's how we did Macbeth when I was 12, and we didn't sit and read it with the form master reading the best part.
He said, "It never occurred to me not to love Shakespeare. He was thrilling and blood-soaked and full of witches."
At about 14, I thought I knew what I wanted to do, be a director.
And the perk of being a station master's son fed his interests.
They had free access to travel on the railways. So my dad, at quite an early age, could just jump on a train and go and see a production and get the cheapest ticket and go and stand in the gods. And he saw everything he possibly could.
I saw John Gielgud's Hamlet standing at the back for sixpence when I was about 14.
Where be your jibes now? Your gambols, your songs, your fleshes of merriment that were wont to set the table on a roar.
Peter became the first of his family to attend university, awarded a scholarship to Cambridge in 1949. But before that, the call came for national service. 18-year-old aircraftman Hall served in England and Germany, where, despite the ravages of war, subsidy had been poured into the arts. Seeing opera, he described it as a physical experience. Returning to Cambridge in 1950, he was inspired.
I felt like a duck who'd found water and could swim.
He found himself amongst a group who would go on to revitalize British theatre for generations to come.
It was at Cambridge that he learnt many of the lessons that we now take to have been invented by him.
A few years his senior was John Barton, already making his mark as a major talent. The two teamed up. It was a time when productions out of Cambridge were drawing attention from all corners.
We did Romeo and Juliet, and Bound Churchill was sitting in the front row of the stalls with a large copy of the first folio glowering at us.
There were about 15 of us who I think came into the theatre saying loudly we could direct. I don't believe any of us could. From a craft point of view, I think we had talent for it, and we also had loud mouths. And there was also a vacuum at that moment, a post-war vacuum in the directing field, no question. There was a hole.
Peter was so hopeful to fill that hole that on arrival at Cambridge, he looked ahead, booking theatre space for an independent production for when he would complete his studies. Studies inspired by the academics F.R. Leavis and Dady Rylands. They gave him a clarity of vision and taught him the importance of theatre.
That was one of the influences in Peter's life, that he wanted anything and everything that he did to have an immediate and potentially life-changing impact.
Graduating in 1953, Peter followed through on his promise, putting on not one but five independent productions. Peter Hall, the theatre director, was launched. Work would never cease. Then, in 1955, at the Art Theatre in London, he had an extraordinary moment.
This play arrived on his desk and I think had been passed from hand to hand and no one had picked it up, and he thought it was remarkable.
I was lucky enough at 24 to be given a script called Waiting for Godot by a dramatist who was virtually unknown.
Now acknowledged as one of the most significant plays of the 20th century, Waiting for Godot, an absurdist work originally written in French by Samuel Beckett, owed its English language premiere to Peter Hall.
You were all packing into the Tiny Arts Theatre. So that was obviously the only theatre that Peter could get at that time. And I remember being absolutely fascinated by the play.
They reached the interval of it, and Harold Hobson, the critic, said, "This is silly shit."
The press was not good. The owner of the Arts Theatre said to me, "We have to take it off on Saturday." And I said, "Wait until Sunday and just see."
Ah, I see what it is. Yes, I see what's happened.
And on Sunday, Harold Hobson in the Sunday Times had had an experience on the road to Damascus and really loved it and wrote about it for the next 7 weeks.
It burst upon an unexpected world, an unexpecting world.
For you, not for him.
The great, insightful Kenneth Tynan said, "This is a fulcrum moment. This is an epoch-making moment. Something completely different has happened in the theatre." with the arrival of Beckett and waiting for Godot, and of course so it was.
It was for Peter a professional triumph. He was the man of the moment, who would never lose his instinct for new talent. He was hired to direct the stage play Gigi, starring French actress Leslie Caron.
Thank heaven for little girl.
The two fell in love, marrying in 1956, with the births of Christopher and Jenny following. Leslie Caron, a glamorous international film star, opened the doors to a brand new world.
My mother had already sort of got a bit further on in her career than he had, and so she had met all sorts of people that he was very interested in their work. And so they'd make a trip to go and see Tennessee Williams in America. And they'd kind of come back with a play, basically.
Tennessee Williams' Cat on a Hot Tin Roof opened in a blaze of publicity and public attention earlier this week. Like the rest of his plays and films, it's controversial, to say the least of it.
In 1958, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof had already been a hit in New York, but was banned by the British censor, the Lord Chamberlain, for its focus on marital misery, violence, and undertones of homosexuality.
This sort of censorship, this pussyfooting way, I think ends up with things being more obscene.
But would you like to abolish censorship as such?
Would yes,
you like
I
to
would.
Abolish the Lord Chamberlain?
Yes, I would. Yes, I would.
Cleverly sidestepping the censor, Peter made viewings of his production private.
Did it shock you?
No, I didn't see it at all. No.
Do you think it's like the life of your neighbours?
Oh, yes. Yes, definitely. It's about my own life, too, in lots of ways.
I mean, people behave in that way, the frustration, depression, money troubles.
I think it's about that we can't bear to tell the truth to each other as human beings.
You can't do a play because it appealed to the public yesterday. Because I mean, if you're going to do plays because you think they're going to be successful with the public's taste has changed by the time you do it. I think my job is trying to interpret the very delicate fluctuations of public opinion and taste in terms of theatre.
Cat on a Hot Tin Roof won Best Play in the 1958 Evening Standard Theatre Awards. And the 1960s saw censorship of stage plays end after more than 200 years. Peter was at the forefront of these changing times, and now he turned his attention to a new and ambitious project.
He made the Royal Shakespeare Company world famous.
It wasn't a new way of dealing with Shakespeare. It was Peter's way of dealing with Shakespeare.
It was absolutely magical.
Stratford-upon-Avon, the birthplace of William Shakespeare, saw Peter, between 1959 and 1961, turn the Shakespeare Memorial Theatre's annual six-month festival into the permanent Royal Shakespeare Company, which, more than 50 years on, remains one of Britain's most important cultural icons.
What Peter did, which was radically different to what had gone before, is in a way summoned up on a picture I have on my office wall. It shows the young Peter Hall and his entire company on the stage at Stratford at the beginning of his tenure. What you see is a company.
His genius was that not only he persuaded the board to take him on, but he also persuaded the board that they should become a fully fledged ensemble company, and nothing existed at the time in the country to parallel that.
He got the royal bit to put in the title. He gave the company a London home, and everybody interested in the theatre knew that the Royal Shakespeare Company existed, and that year by year it would be putting on plays with always with high standards, and that productions would have a long life. Stratford, London, maybe a tour, maybe an international tour.
What he was absolutely determined to do was to bring the best people, the best exponents, the best people who were talking to the world, to Stratford and to the Aldwych, to work on Shakespeare's plays and to work on modern plays together.
And because he was young and he'd got a young company, We all got very exhilarated and found this extremely exciting.
He was only 29 when he created the RSC. And Peter was already showing great eloquence, becoming increasingly vocal as a campaigner for arts subsidy.
If you mean that I am in the theatre not to make money, not necessarily to entertain, but because I believe theatre fulfills a social function which is needful for society, yes, I am committed.
Peter not only had the ability to make a speech flow, he had the ability to persuade.
In 1963, when public subsidy wasn't an accepted principle, Peter secured the RSC's first grant from the Arts Council. That same year, the RSC dazzled audiences with an ambitious adaptation of the history plays, The Wars of the Roses. And he launched a new star.
To find myself on the same stage with Peggy Ashcroft, with Paul Robeson, and the great Ian Holm.
My lords.
And the first week I went around apologising to every member of the company for getting the part of Henry VI, because I couldn't understand why it came to me, because my theatre experience was very, very small.
And therefore, by His Majesty I swear, whose far unworthy deputy I am, he shall not breathe infection in this air, but 3 days longer on the pain of death.
We should remember that Peter was the most brave espouser of experiments in theatrical language and form.
Let me plead for gentle Suffolk.
Gentle queen to call him gentle Suffolk.
He and Barton were incredibly cavalier in their use of the text, the way they put, they wanted a piece of effective theatre. They made it.
The world shall not be ransomed for thy life.
Well, it was a big evening, and it was one where people were pretty exhausted coming out of it and bowled over by it.
And so Peter and John Barton together reconceived him as a political writer, which is what Shakespeare had never been thought of. Shakespeare had always been thought of being about the eternal truths of humanity. And, you know, this rather pious approach to Shakespeare, it's about character. And suddenly they were being presented as if they were about Harold Wilson's government, these plays, and as if they were about now.
It just made it very accessible. It was thrilling. Thrilling. I mean, the staging was thrilling. It was metallic. It was leather. It was just so of its time. I mean, it felt contemporary.
He certainly should have been overwhelmingly proud of The Wars of the Roses because it so changed everything. And we continue to think of it as one of the seminal Shakespeare productions.
The company Peter Hall had created put British theatre on the global map.
We have, all in all, a total company of about 500 people.
Quarter of an hour, please, ladies and gentlemen. Quarter of an hour.
We're doing film work. Two companies at Stratford. Possibility of an American tour early next year.
He once said, paradise to him would be rehearsing Shakespeare for 1 month, Mozart for the next month, to eternity.
Before each production, he talks to the whole company, actors, scene masters, everybody, about his ideas on the play.
So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are not going to read the play, embarrass each other and ourselves, but I want to put certain ideas into your heads about my feeling about the play.
In 1968, Peter directed his first feature film with his original RSC cast.
I'm making a film, The Midsummer Night's Dream. I would like to be able to make a film which had my handwriting, whatever that is, because that's what I admire in the cinema. And I doubt very much if I can do it. I felt rather like a man who's resisted an insidious drug for 13 years because he knew he would love it. I loved it, but I don't know if anyone will love the result.
My experience of my father in film actually started with his film version of Midsummer Night's Dream, where I think I was 8, and I would visit the set, and one of my jobs was to paint the naked Judi Dench green.
My costume was only some ivy leaves stuck to me in strategic places, and then I was sprayed green.
Therefore the winds piping to us in vain, as in revenge have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which falling in the land have every pelting river made so proud.
Everybody was in it, and all their kids, so we were all dressed in leaves in the woods as fairies.
Hand in hand with fairy grace, will we sing and bless this place?
I was known as Fairy Grace after that because I had to pop up underneath Oberon and Titania at the end when they said, hand in hand with Fairy Grace.
The film was nominated for an Emmy and showcased Peter's stringent rules on how to speak verse.
He's very, very, very precise about how to obey the iambic pentameter, the lines, and the rhythm of the lines and the punctuation.
When I first came to work here as a freelance director, you didn't talk to actors about their text. I mean, it was an infringement on their technique. They knew their job. Of course, they didn't.
Where you breathed, the way in which it was phrased, all of these things were absolutely rules, as far as he was concerned, which could not be varied.
Weep our sad bosoms empty, let us rather do this.
So Peter would stand in front of the actors latterly with a lectern and the script and not much looking at the actors, listening to them.
And like good men, bestride our downfall, Berthdom.
And follow the rhythm of the line with his finger and even beat it out for you.
I'm miserable, it's nothing. You can't be miserable, we must do something.
He could see the pattern, those notes that you were supposed to play.
Again, a fair pullback. It's a bit of a ramantando on that line.
If there was a house style, it was that approach to text.
He also believed that contemporary works were as important as the classics. In 1965, he suggested a modern work shocking in tone.
Peter had distributed a new play by Harold Pinter called The Homecoming, and he was asking opinions around the table, reactions around the table, and in the end, Peter asked for a vote, and it was absolutely clear that most people were voting against.
And apparently he listened very, very carefully and respectfully to them and said, I do understand your point, and I see exactly what you're talking about.
Peter said, well, thank you all very much for your view. I think it's a masterpiece. I don't care what any of you think, I'm doing it.
Who's this?
I was just going to introduce you.
Who asked you to bring tarts in here?
Tarts?
Who asked you to bring dirty tarts into this house?
If you were lucky enough to see it on the Broadway or London stage, it still haunts you.
The 1973 feature film, directed by Peter with the RSC cast, showed faith in both the play and the playwright.
Look, next time you come over, don't forget to let us know beforehand whether you're married or not. I'll always be glad to meet the wife, honest, I'm telling you. Mind you, she's a lovely girl.
I would say The Homecoming was as shocking as all great new works in the theatre must always be.
Harold Pinter's The Homecoming. It's not about the family next door, or is it?
He still loves his father.
And Harold Pinter is a very, very hard-line writer. In other words, he simply thinks the text is the text and the job of the director is to put the text on the stage. There is no collaboration, there's no rewriting. You're simply there to serve the writer.
Pinter writes with the pauses are in little dots. And he got a message from Pinter at one point in rehearsal saying, now on page 3, line 4, the sentence that ends with 3 dots, can you make it 4?
I have first-hand experience of the Peter Hall, Harold Pinter relationship, and it was symbiotic. Harold didn't speak very much, but Peter spoke for him, and frequently it was as if Harold was talking directly to the company, and their closeness of connection was formidable.
Peter described the RSC as built upon a series of creative relationships, but by the mid-1960s, his most significant relationship had broken down.
The pressures of her in Hollywood and me in Warwickshire, it was just a mess.
In 1965, Peter married his personal assistant, Jacqueline Taylor. The births of their two children, Edward and Lucy, followed, making Peter a father of four. Later that decade, he reached a surprise decision to take his leave of the Royal Shakespeare Company.
I said to Peter, all right, I will mind the shop. You're going to go away, you're going to do other things, but on the understanding that one day you're going to come back, I will look after your company for you.
He turned to his great love of music, beginning work with the Royal Opera at Covent Garden. But it didn't last long.
In an opera house, the man who does the staging takes second place to the conductor. And I think Peter liked being in control.
If I could have my wish, I would, and you said, right, you can be anything you want, yeah. I would say I would be a conductor.
But you'd be a conductor?
Absolutely.
In spite of this, he would go on to bring the skills he had learnt in theatre to the world's leading opera houses, including Glyndebourne.
I must also say about Glyndebourne, they do take the director seriously. They do put the dramatic very high on the list. Not certainly above the music, and it never should be. I'm not saying that, but it's equal.
Particularly important were his interpretations of Mozart's Da Ponte operas, and with conductor Raymond Leppard, rediscovery of the Baroque operas, such as La Callisto.
One of the most exciting things was the fact that he would gather the cast together, and he expounded what his idea was behind the general piece in very general terms. This is what I'm trying to aim for.
You have to play.
Which was very illuminating and interesting.
He's looking at you, yes, you're going to meet his eyes, and now he's stopped.
I remember him saying to me, you know, one thing about opera before I did it was that people used to sing love duets without looking at each other.
You always felt that he was, whatever it was he was asking for, was for very good reason, and one felt that he was trying to make you at ease with what he wanted all the time. It was just, from my point of view, a pure joy from beginning to end.
I want to recognise, though, how awful opera usually is. And yet we all go on working in it and going to see it because at its best, which is very rare, I think it's the best form of theatre.
Outstanding for me was the production of Midsummer Night's Dream, Britain's Midsummer Night's Dream, at Glyndebourne.
But a serpent did my heart away, and you set smiling.
Seemed to me absolutely exemplary. Real understanding and sympathy for both for the play on which the opera was based and for the music.
To understand the difficulties of natural movement and the use of language in prescribed bar lines must have been second nature to him.
To be or not to be, that is the question. You know, that is an aria. It's about that moment.
In opera, you are given the end result. You're given the tempo, the atmosphere, the reality. You can't muck about with that. You have to work backwards. What do they have to feel in order to make that the necessary expression, the music?
Again, passionate about music sounds like the wrong phrase. It feels like it was almost actually just part of his life force.
We
when you knew Peter, you knew about music because it absorbed him. He loved it. He loved it. It was in his bones. I mean, absolutely adored it.
Never work shy, the 1970s saw Peter take on more and more in opera, theatre and film, making his most personal work Aikenfield, about a lost world of rural Suffolk life, based on a book by Ronald Blythe.
The book made me realise how much of my actual childhood I had shut out from myself, because I do understand these people and love them. I heard my own grandfather talking again about agricultural life in East Anglia, the miseries, the horrors, the unemployment, and that we were the oppressed.
We always sang as we worked through the corn. You asked me what the song was. I didn't mind the song. That was the singing that counted.
In a way, it's a big home movie, in that yes. We actually went on making it until we thought we'd finished it.
Hello? What are you doing here, then?
He relied heavily upon locals rather than actors, including his father.
Oh. Are you all right, Dulcie?
Yeah, fine.
I think I had to record that about 15 or 16 times before he said it was satisfactory.
He did see himself in some way as a subject of the film. Something that moved him was the final sequence where the young man leaving encounters himself coming back.
He walked the whole way, that was 40 miles there and 40 miles back.
We never got the job, you see.
He would say, well, you and I got lucky. We left and we didn't meet ourselves coming back.
Who would I have been if I hadn't footed it back home?
At the age of 43, Peter embarked upon his toughest challenge. It would see him become the most powerful and at times most criticized man in theatre.
It was late afternoon and we talked about all sorts of things in the English theatre as it got darker and darker. As we got into twilight, Peter said the most devastating thing I'd ever heard him utter. He said, well, the point is that I have been asked to take on the running of the National Theatre. Total silence.
Based in London at the Old Vic since 1963, the National Theatre was the historic rival to the Royal Shakespeare Company, even before its long-awaited expansion to the South Bank. Peter's appointment was seen as a stab in the back to Sir Laurence Olivier, the man who'd run the National since its launch.
And it took them quite some time to break the news to Olivier.
Because everybody loved Olivier, of course, and they loved the Old Vic. So there was a great swell of what on earth is going on, this huge, expensive new building being run by this extremely young man.
I have the greatest pride in the fact that my successor is a man of such enormous talent as Peter Hall.
Yeah. It was a symbolic point. The actor-manager was replaced by the director-manager, but he'd earned the right to do that because he'd founded the Royal Shakespeare Company.
I mean, he was taking on an established company, but his biggest trial was taking on an uncompleted, massive building.
The sheer size of the operation caused Hall to sound, early on, a warning note.
It's still going to have very little change from £1 million a year just to have the building standing there. No actors, no management, no productions. And that cost will have to be met from somewhere. Otherwise, we might just as well not have it.
The new National Theatre is large, unfamiliar and late. Delays on the site will prevent public performances until autumn at the earliest.
Well, it was a difficult time within the country in the 70s because there was a political upheaval, three-day weeks, all sorts of terrible things.
As recession loomed, the scale and ambition of the three new theatre spaces were under constant scrutiny.
Nobody knew how expensive it was, but Peter came through it extremely well. He was very calm, seemingly. and clever.
I believe that the more theatre there is, the more theatre there'll be, because I think it creates audience, it gives greater security to the profession. And I think that when you look back in the 80s and 90s on the arrival of the National Theatre in the 70s, it will be seen as making the theatre secure. I'm absolutely sure of that. I know that.
But in a way, the more important thing about Peter was to be a figurehead, an articulate figurehead.
So, in spite of all the delays, what does the director think of the new building?
I think it's brilliant. I think it's one of the few bits of great modern architecture that this country's done since the war. And as far as theatres are concerned, I think all of us are overjoyed at the prospect of working in here.
He was the building. I met him one day in the corridor and I said, "Oh, I didn't know you were in. The flag's not flying." And he said, "Oh, don't be like that."
Three years into Peter's tenure, the new building finally opened. And with it, a new experience.
He said the doors are going to be open at 10 o'clock and people are going to be able to drink coffee, come in, talk, all sorts of other events will happen in the theatre. We're going to be open to the city, as he put it.
To fill these theatre spaces, Peter knew that the work of contemporary dramatists was essential.
It's an extraordinarily important occasion, simply because it's a long campaign that modern plays do belong on the classical stage.
I came from the Fringe Theatre, and people argued to me, "Oh, it's going to be an establishment theatre, and you shouldn't be working there." And I would say, well, Peter Hall appears to be saying that I can write what I want, and I can put it on in the way I want, I will direct it, and I can address exactly what subjects I want. There'll be no censorship. And everything this man has promised me, he's always given me.
Weapons of Happiness by Howard Brenton, directed by David Hare, a highly charged political thriller reflecting the times, opened at the new National Theatre.
That we should be able to address the people in the audience about the things that concern their own lives at the time that they are happening. That, in other words, the National Theatre would be the nation talking to the nation. And it became that straight away.
He said, so I want you to write a play for the new National Theatre. And I got my answer prepared, which was all sort of humming and hawing. And he said one of his great Peter Hall lines, "Alan, you can well do without the National Theatre, but ask yourself this, can the National Theatre do without you?" And my ego was so inflated, I went, "Oh, well, yes, I'll put like that."
Bedroom Fast, the play he wrote for Peter, was put on at the Littleton in 1977, giving Alan Ayckbourn his London debut as a director and giving the National what it needed.
And it was sort of like a mega success. It was huge. He brought me in to the National as a sort of court jester figure. Because I came from the slum side, from the West End, and I was adopted by Uncle Peter to come over and play with the big boys.
One of the mythologies of our age is that if you are in any way successful or head an institution, you have, quote, sold out. All one can do is to ensure that the questions go on being asked day by day, week after week. And the theatre, in its small way, has a part in that.
Despite a strong repertoire, by 1979, as Britain faced widespread industrial action, the National faced appalling financial straits with funding cutbacks and high running costs.
Do you believe that the National Theatre will ever be a paying proposition, that it'll ever be in the black?
Oh, no, of course not. Why should we think it will? If you've got... that's not wrong. If you compare it with any other comparable theatre organisation in the world, it's terrific value for money.
The dramatic battle, as he termed it in his diaries, was to maintain the integrity of subsidised theatre amid financial crisis. An important victory came with a play centred on the life of Mozart.
Doesn't really work, that force, does it?
Amadeus by Peter Schaffer, a much-loved work performed thousands of times around the world, began its life in 1979. A brand new work with a brand new star.
Good.
Peter Hall had cast me as Mozart without ever having seen my work or without ever having met me. I never spoke to him before. So he obviously had huge confidence, I suppose you might say, in me, but even more than that, he had huge confidence in himself. He just felt, you know, he would make it work.
Pushing boundaries, Mozart was written as vulgar, and his wife Constanza as childish, a dream part.
That was a pretty impressive way to start working for Peter, for me. I was very, well, I suppose in one sense I was very young and took it in my stride. On the other, I couldn't believe my luck and my good fortune.
And then suddenly, high above it.
The original production saw Salieri played by Paul Scofield. But as Amadeus transferred to Broadway, it gave another actor his big break.
It was quite daring of Peter. I wasn't a name. I wasn't a Paul Scofield. I hadn't got an Oscar under my belt. And he really had to persuade the American producers that it would be all right.
It was all right. Amadeus won 13 awards. In 1981, Peter went into production on a bold venture linked to his love of music, form and mask in the Oresteia.
No end to it all. Though all year I've muttered my pleas to the gods for long groped for end.
It was a world of theatre that nobody had ever seen before. It was an extraordinary vision of a form of theatre of such strangeness.
But when you're through from Clancy...
I think to put the Oresteia on the Olivier stage with the whole history of how Denis Lasdon had conceived that theatre as a Greek theatre, and to put the greatest Greek plays on in a wonderful masked production that made absolutely no concessions to the present day at all, was at the other end of his work.
Well, certainly everybody remembers it. All my life people have said, you know, God, like, love the Oresteia.
Then make the inner city yours.
Before the Oresteia, I'd just done the Romans in Britain, in which I was completely stark naked from beginning to end. And of course that's gone down in the annals of theatrical history as a very notorious production. Ironically, the very next project I did, I was completely covered head to foot, including my face, in a mask. So I went from total nudity to being completely covered up. And he once said to me, you do know that you are revealing more in a mask than you ever did with all your clothes off.
He believed theatre must always take chances. In 1982, The National took another, its first Broadway musical, a revival of Guys and Dolls, directed by Richard Eyre.
There was a lot of opposition to it. There was a lot of, you know, outcry that the National Theatre shouldn't be doing Broadway musicals. And Peter weathered all this criticism with his characteristic bravura, and the gamble paid off.
Their production ran for almost 4 years, breaking box office records, offering reprieve in the face of further cutbacks. But by 1984, the National Theatre faced bankruptcy. Peter called a public meeting, climbing onto a coffee table to make a point.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. We warned the Arts Council in 1982 that if our reward for good housekeeping was going to be year after year of grant increase, which was less than half of inflation, there would be a day of reckoning.
I can remember the anger in his tone at that meeting when he was talking about public subsidy theatre, which he cared desperately for and thought that the theatre would have little future without it.
The quickest way to cut costs is, tragically, to go dark in the Cotswolds. there will inevitably be job losses among actors and staff.
Peter's power as a public figure made him a lot of enemies in politicians who resented the fact that he was a man who had a great deal of charisma, a great deal of force as a public spokesman, and was dabbling in the areas of politics that should have been left to politicians.
He had a reputation for being a great politician, but actually I think he was an incredibly naive politician, because he always assumed that everybody was in as much good faith as he was.
Now, Lord, Sir Peter Hall has led the attack on the Arts Council, on this government and myself.
We live in a democracy. We have to shout, and we have to shout loud, and we have to protest, and we have to tell people that one of the great particular things of our cultural heritage is being destroyed.
Ever since, I think, directors of the National Theatre of Great Britain have felt that they do have a responsibility beyond the job for which they're being paid.
Editorial freedom. You never used it when you had it. It is fast gone.
The Cottesloe reopened with a grant from the Greater London Council, and the 1980s saw the National on a more secure footing, with a flurry of new work, such as Pravda, a modern satire attacking Fleet Street and the government.
Bored, very, very unhappy about a play attacking the press. Tried to get it read legally, tried to get it defanged. Once more, Peter, as he had been over the crisis of Romans of Britain, 100% stalwart, 100% behind the artists, never budged in his defense of the people he believed in.
Nor had he turned his back on Shakespeare, with Judy Dench and Anthony Hopkins mesmerizing as Antony and Cleopatra.
You could have taken a Martian, and the Martian would have immediately understood why we thought Shakespeare was a great writer and why the work was still contemporary.
I once said to him, "Are you going to have a holiday after this?" He said, "No, a holiday, why?" He said, "No." He said, "I'm a director." Couldn't bear the thought of not doing it.
His personal life had changed a great deal in his 15 years as head of the National Theatre. In 1977, he'd become Sir Peter Hall, knighted by the Queen for services to theatre. And in 1982, he'd married for the third time. At Glyndebourne, where he had continued to direct, he'd met Maria Ewing, an opera star. The birth of their daughter, Rebecca, followed, making Peter a father of five. He'd left the National Theatre in 1988, setting up the Peter Hall Company.
On me, my bargains, and my well-won thrift, which he calls interest.
Memorably casting Dustin Hoffman in his first Shakespearean role as Shylock, and Vanessa Redgrave in Orpheus Descending, which he also turned into a film.
I used to tease Peter a lot because he didn't used to watch us. By that time, he used to just look at his script.
Don't let him holler, then the audience knows what we're going to do.
But I did love being in it, and I loved working with him again.
If you'll excuse me for telling you so, you're just about the rudest talking woman I ever met.
Yeah, mean inside.
By 1990, his marriage to Maria was over. At the age of 59, he took his fourth and final wife, Nicola Fry, a publicist and scriptwriter. The couple went on to share more than 2.5 decades of happiness together, with Peter saying, "It's taken me a lifetime to achieve the marriage I'd hoped for." Their daughter, Emma, was born in 1992, making Peter a father of six. And all of his children have followed him into the arts.
A lot of people think, well, we must have had deprived childhoods because he always was working. I dispute that. He was a wonderful father. He was always accessible. He was always there for us.
Family was very important to him. I mean, that was quite paradoxical that he managed to have so many families.
He always said that he'd had the privilege of 50 years of small children. And in fact, my eldest son is older than my youngest half-sister.
I always have seen this person who feels very, very, you know, he was working, of course, a lot when we were all children, but he was there for us. Even if he wasn't physically there, he was there. We would all convene in row G at his first nights, or row K thereabouts, you know, but we'd practically fill the whole row. There's so many of us. He loved having children, grandchildren, everybody around him.
Some of my recollections of Sundays, it would tend to be a script, him sitting in a Charles Eames chair or something, a Havana cigar, and Wagner or Mozart, very loud. It was smells, it was sound, it was the concentration of the man at work.
Peter directed for the screen throughout his career. One of his most successful productions was for Channel 4 in 1992. The Chamomile Lawn, based upon a Mary Wesley book about the last summer before World War II.
May we ask the Floyd twins over?
Of course. Telephone and ask them to lunch tomorrow. Such nice boys.
Extraordinary, considering their father's a conchie.
He loved the process and the fact that every single second of the day he was being asked a question and he was part of it.
Go on, Sophie!
Go on, Soaps!
It was also the screen debut of 9-year-old Rebecca Hall.
She's off. Walter's unleashed her.
He would always throw everything at you and sort of trust your ability to work it out. And I think that's right. It didn't do me any harm. I felt very... I think it gave me a lot of confidence.
His autobiography and published diaries revealed a complex character, capable of both great despair and sensitivity.
It's the one thing I don't like about my life and never have. I'm actually quite shy, and I don't like public life very much. I don't like parties, I don't like receptions. I don't even like giving television interviews.
It's pretty uncomfortable for playing. I'm in direct contact with the circle. But I also want to look to the infinite.
I think the small change of intimacy was difficult for Peter. And I think it was because he became a public figure so early. He was so young. And he almost had no adult life, just bumming around and hanging out.
Peter really fulfilled the dictum of I direct to live and I live to direct.
Sorry, change my mind.
There was a deep pool of real fragility.
There's a sort of emotional inscrutability about Peter. And even in his diaries where he says, you know, where he contemplates suicide, you somehow think, there's nothing leading up to that. You wouldn't be able to see that on Peter's face.
So what do you do when you meet a man who you think has written something which has been desperately cruel?
I say good evening to him.
Do you smile?
Yes.
That's a tremendous, an enviable characteristic, not to be subverted by depression and a sense of failure, and just go on to see what is round the next corner.
He continued to work throughout his 70s. In 2003, becoming founding director of the Rose Theatre Kingston, a space he felt real passion for. At 75, directing Measure for Measure and Miss Julie at the Theatre Royal Bath, he continued his lifelong trait of unearthing new talent.
You meet someone who is so experienced and such an intellect and has such rhythm, you know, like in his bones, Peter has rhythm. I cannot even express how grateful I feel to have worked with him.
You know, my impression of him always was that he wanted to be loved, and I loved him.
To mark his 80th birthday, he directed Twelfth Night back at the National Theatre, and featuring his daughter.
Tempests are kind, and salt waves.
It was incredibly meaningful for him. He loved that theatre, and he loved what it stood for. And he loved it, like, very, very much.
The last time I worked with him, which was on Twelfth Night, when he was perhaps not at his best. But then there would come little flashes of the old ability to just encapsulate something. And he said to me, for example, I was playing Toby Belch, he said, "It's so wonderful that you love this language so much, that you relish it with such richness and such response to it. Maybe a little too much." He got it absolutely right.
In 2011, he was diagnosed with dementia. He spent his last years as a proud father, grandfather, and husband. Sir Peter Hall, a man of the theatre, film, and opera, who held a mirror up to nature in his contemporary work, who carried forward the classics, and who never lacked the belief in the next generation. A man who, in everything he did, strove to keep the arts at the center of the universe.
The privilege of being intimately connected with a man who one thinks of in terms of genius is almost impossible to describe.
And he created the principle of the living playwright being as important as the dead in the life of the nation's theatre.
It gave a sense of passionate political commitment that I think is his legacy for certainly this company today.
To be held in hands like that, that understood and had so much compassion for us all. I mean, he knew what we were all going through.
I can't imagine what it would have been like without Peter. I don't know.